out of every 60 manuscripts, it must be a package insert. It must be this small role. And this package insert must contain registration, scheduling, genetic and strain names, blah blah blah, must support DNA, pharmacological classification, mechanism of action, I don't know what's something there. Indication, what is an indication?
What's it
done? What's it done? Yes. Now, indication, for example, can be inaccurate. Indication, the warning. What is a warning?
What you must expect.
Yes, by warning. People with low blood pressure, when taking paracetamol, for example, can maybe faint. That's a warning. Now, not an absolute medication, but a warning. So people who are just in this problem should take any medication. That's a warning. Then a contraindication. What is a contraindication? Any idea? You should be confident. You should be confident, confident. What is a contraindication? What is a contraindication? So contraindication would be a condition that prohibits you from taking this medication. So for example, if you're pregnant and you want to take any point. Any point is contraindication. If you have a right heart failure and you want to take, I'm making things up now, so I can't think of anyone now. But the idea is there's a lot of conditions that will contraindicate some medications to you. Because if you take those medications, they will be detrimental to you. Okay, so think about taking one and you're taking when you open the package and you look inside of it, you can see you have Lasix 40 milligrams. Lasix is furosemide. And you will see for renal dysfunction, you would use 40 milligrams twice a day. So the package insert must give you also some dosage directions. But I want to emphasize this. A lot of the package inserts are very old.
I've seen.
A lot of package inserts are 2002, 1988,
yeah.
Crazy days. A lot of researchers have it from then. You already might eventually do an MSc in pharmacology in nursing. And then when you're doing your research, you maybe, for example, want to see if double the dose of Lasix or furosemide improves the renal dysfunction. Then you will do a study and you will publish your results. And your results will not be included into the package instead of a company. So the package insert gives you some guidance, but it's not really current evidence-based. Package insert should be a last resort, not a first priority. First priority should be accurate knowledge. Knowledge that you acquire now, evidence-based knowledge. So, you guys have been doing research somewhere else along the line, I'm guessing, then you would see the example. For example, I've got nitrile. You guys are using the EML a lot? The EML and the same people guide on? If you are practicing in South Africa in the public sector, you must use your standard treatment guidelines and your email to appropriately diagnose a person and then appropriately treat the person. So according to that criteria listed in that standard treatment guidelines, you would then say, this person suffering from this degree of asthma should get this much cortisone. And then you follow the standard treatment guidelines and they give you the most up-to-date information based on evidence. And they change the standard guidelines and the EML every year. It gets updated every year. There's so much information being produced around the world. And all of the information, the package insert, becomes almost irrelevant. So, you can rely on it. but it's not everything. A lot of information out there that you will not necessarily get from a fact sheet instantly. Okay. I think I'm just going to skip this. So, the registration of medicines, the numbers, the structure of the numbers tells you something about the medicine. It's not important to you guys, you will never use it again. Then I did the same thing twice. Okay, now we get to this. What do you know about homeopathy? Complementary medicine, heard of it? So when you're walking around in Biscayne, man, it doesn't even look rich, and you're walking through the vitamin section, and then you get the herbal section. All of those things are useless. They don't have proof of actually working. And in a lot of the cases, the things that actually did work contain pharmaceuticals. So a good example is, they have this man performance booster, for example. I love using this one because it's easy to explain. So they have this heart not leaking, and they have all of these manpower boosters. And then when they actually took it, because they can sell it free, you know, then when they actually took it and they tested it through an HPLC machine, they found sildenafil. So sildenafil is Viagra. So they found Viagra in something that's not controlled. So the company producing it simply keep it. And you put it on a single thing that's actually fine inside there and say, oh, schedule zero, it just works. Our plant material works. The plant material never works, it's just lying. So that's the problem with these complementary medicines, herbal medicines, etc. They're not regulated, so it's impossible to know what you actually take. And there's a lot of cases there is no good evidence, but it's very seldom that there is actually evidence supporting it. So that's homeopathy. Homeopathy is so all of these things, is, you just never fall for it. Don't fall for complementary medicines, don't fall for homeopathy, don't fall for... There are some herbs that work, but you can search yourself to death and you still won't have an accurate guidance about who you want. So I think there are a lot of things that actually did work, and we are getting some research out there, so we have an idea what we can do with it. But it's still a thing in progress. It's not really anything. Based on numbers, probably not. It's, have you seen what's going on around the world these days? It's scary. So misinformation at the moment is like grabbing the world. Think about you've heard of this anti-vaccine thing, right? Mm-hmm. The anti-vaxxers. In America, we've got the anti-vaxxers everywhere. Who believes vaccinations are wrong? We've got two people. So I want to start the argument with you guys now. But it would be a good argument, because it's carried on for a long time. So, but there's a lot of evidence, it's overwhelming that vaccinations save people's lives. It's overwhelming. But for some reason, people choose not to believe it. And that's how it's becoming a thing in the world today. Because we've got information that contradicts the misinformation, but people choose to believe the misinformation. It's becoming a thing in society now. So people also choose to believe complementary medicines. They choose to believe it, even though they don't have any evidence to guide them, but they choose to believe it. Misinformation is becoming a real problem. So they actually, the World Health Organization released a statement just the other day saying that one of the biggest threats to health in the world at the moment is anti-vaccinations. So 1 in 3 Americans believe that you should not vaccinate your child. And they've got now the first time ever polio outbreaks and measles outbreaks. If you don't know polio, some of you get polio, or I'm not sure if it was for the young or because they can get malformed, and then they start like that forever. And polio was completely eradicated in America, now it's bad. What was the point of bringing it back? Anyways, misinformation, terrible. You guys must be educated in everything you do. I don't really know much about nursing prescribers and dispensers, but I do know if you guys have a nursing degree, you can eventually just apply to do a dispensing course, and then you can dispense medications, and you guys can prescribe. I'm not sure, can you guys prescribe from the start, or do you have to do a course to prescribe? A course, okay, so you have to do a course to prescribe. And I think even if you've done that course, you are limited on what you can prescribe. So you will never be able to dispense schedule 5, prescribe schedule 5, for example. So once again, it's very important to know your drugs if you want to start prescribing them. It's actually always funny to me how a doctor is the one prescribing and they're the one dispensing it. There should be more communication about it because doctors don't know much about medications and their pharmacies. You guys actually doing a year course. A lot of medical courses in the country is only 6 months pharmacology. You guys are doing a year, so I'm actually very glad. Okay, rules of administration. Do you guys know the rules of administration of drugs?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm gonna have a good book. It wasn't in the book, I just added it to be safe. I'm just scared about that now. So if I say a brain food, what do you think of?
IV.
IV, yes. Subcutaneous IV, intradermal. Yes, all those are correct. Do you need it all or do you not?
No.
Okay, I'm glad. Oral tablets, you get subcutaneous mucal tablets, and you get what's that?
Subcutaneous.
You better teach me again. Okay. I think this is the last slide. Let's just start with rational investigations. All of this is actually completely logical. Common sense. This is common sense, actually. But for some reason, it must be explained to some people, because some people will never do it. So, if I have three patients here, I understand vehicles are wrong as well. You get very busy, I don't understand vehicles. If I have three patients here, you have heart failure, you have, I don't know if I get something embarrassing because you don't have to make it something. So, heart failure, you have a DVT in your leg, and you've got extract. There's three different treatments. So, obviously, you cannot interchange the medications. What would happen? Catastrophe.
Thank you.